I'm going to be doing a whole series of arrowhead types out of this Alabates. Excuse me. So a lot of these videos will seem a little bit repetitive, but this one's not going to be a Perdice. This will be a side notch. And I've got plenty more Alabates. I'll be doing some other different types of arrowheads. It kind of reminds me of Flint Ridge, but not as easy to flake, but it's extremely hard. It does remind me of Flint Ridge. And I'm also not wearing finger protection. A lot of times with these really hard materials, you're not going to get those very tiny slivers of stone. So I'm not worried about cutting myself with this. The edges are very sharp, but they're not as sharp as glass. There's a defect in the stone right here. There's an internal fracture. I don't think it goes very far. Everything else looks really good on this piece. Now you might be able to tell how hard I hit it by the level of sound coming from these strikes. I'm not sure. I just reviewed some of my videos and you can kind of tell how hard I hit by the sound level. That was a really hard strike there. That was a really hard strike too. It looks like it cleared out some of that fracture. Okay, I think that was the last of it with that last strike. It's been really dusty and windy lately, so I think my allergies are acting up. I gotta clear my throat quite a bit. Sorry about that. I could probably do that faster with percussion. It's a very typical problem with flakes that curve. After a while, after doing a lot like that, it just comes naturally on how to correct that curve. I mean, you'll get used to it and correct it without even thinking about it after a while. And I attack this pretty much the same way as I attack the bottle bottoms, with the curve like that. I like working the convex side more than the concave side. As you can see, there's still a lot of the original flake scar on the concave side. Okay, I'm going to pressure flake it all the way around, and then I'll figure out the best strategy for removing this mass here and these steps. I'm going to try to move quickly on this one. Okay, so most of that curve is taken out. There's still some raised areas right there. A little bit of mass right here. This edge dips down. But for the most part, it's straightened out, and this stage is critical because I don't want to get too thin, because there's one more pass after this, and I don't want to try to thin down a really thin point. I could make it a lot thinner at this stage, but got to be careful. Like I said, there's one more pass to go, so I'm just going to pressure flake around here and again. So what this is I'm just dressing the edge. Some people call it blending or removing the deltas. I'm doing two things at once. I'm thinning the raised areas, but I'm also shaping the overall shape. I know I'm going to lose a little bit of width on the final pass, so the edge. Usually these edges will be straight on the finished point. I'm leaving them a little bit convex for the final pass. I just call this stage dressing the edge. There's more going on than just blending or removing the deltas. Okay, there's some stepping going on this side that I'm going to remove on this next pass. That step there, that one there, this one there, that one there. There's also a step in the middle here. Right here. Now on the real ones, they didn't really spend too much time removing these step fractures. But I like doing it. I want this base to be thin where I'm going to drive the notches. I want them to be fairly narrow. It gives it a smart look to it. I dropped my mallet. Now on the real ones, a lot of times they tend to favor one side. So what I mean by that is they'll remove flakes on one side, flip it over, remove flakes on that same side, and when you look at it from the front, it looks like it's almost twisted a little bit. I'm not going to do that on this. I'm just going to attack the problem areas and do a random flaking style and try to get it as thin as possible. There's just a little bit of the original flake showing here, so on this next few flakes, that'll be it for the original surface. Now on the base, I don't want to drive straight in because that produces a lot of bending stress, so I'm going to drive flakes at an angle, not straight in but at an angle like this. So I'm going to be shooting flakes down this way as I progress along the bottom. You gotta be careful not to take too much bite on the base. It's a very brittle material. I probably should have braided that edge. Sometimes I get lazy and skip that step. Some materials will allow you to skip the abrading, but this material is not very forgiving. Thank you. going to try to power through that step fracture right there. Alright, so just a few more flakes. There's still a lot of little steps in here, which are not too bad. This material is good for hiding that. It also hides the flake scar pattern, but the colors make up for it. Anyway, I'm going to do one more series of flakes down this edge to try to clear that up, and then I'll notch it. Okay, that's good enough. I'll dress the edge a little bit before I notch it. I can save this step for the last part, but right now it's just bugging me that this edge is not dressed, so I'm going to do it now. And just as a side note, some archaeological texts will try to describe the technique for flaking. How it was done. Sometimes they really don't have a good concept of how to run flakes on a point. They feel that if flakes are run diagonally in a certain way, it's because the napper was left or right-handed, and or thoughts like that along those lines. But as you can see, I'll show you that you can run flakes in any direction you want, regardless of left or right-handedness. If I hold the workpiece like this, I can push in and run flakes this way underneath, or I can do the same thing this way with a series of flakes and run them just the opposite. Of course, it gets difficult when you're in this position, but you can still do it. You can still run flakes that way, which is just the opposite of running them that way underneath, and I'm right-handed. So it's often difficult for archaeologists to conceptualize this, but you can run flakes in any direction regardless of whether you're right or left-handed. Okay, that's just a side note. I'll discuss stuff like that in other videos. I was just thinking about that right now. My mind kind of wanders when I'm dressing the edge. Okay, I'm going to try to pop out the initial flakes with a percussion. That way I can run a narrow notch. And you'll see what I mean in a minute. I'm going to pop out these next flakes with percussion, which will give me a large bulb. And the danger is blowing away the edge, but I got plenty of width, so I can correct that. I blew away some of the edge on this notch, but it was common on the real ones too. A lot of times one notch is more narrow than the other. Now I might just do this entirely with percussion. I think the tool's thin enough. This one. I've got a more narrow tool, but I think this will work. Just got to be real careful. With this material especially, because it can snap right across the notches, it's very brittle. It's the same with technique as pressure. I square off the bottom and then I flip it over and take another flake. Okay. I think that's pushing my luck a little bit too much on this one. It's thin enough that I can crunch these notches in with a pressure flake or a little bit more, and that'll look pretty good. It's already 48, almost 49 minutes, and I still gotta sharpen my pressure flaker. And the way I'm doing this, if you were looking at it from the side view, I'm doing this. It's not flat on the steel, it's up off the steel so I can kind of do a hollow ground type of surface, where this is actually concave right in here leading up to the tip, or you know, slightly concave, and then the tip of course will drop off. But right here, I'm trying to remove material from right in here. That's what'll kill you, this width in here. When you're trying to do a narrow notch, this is too wide, you'll just break off the edges of the notch. That's good enough. I'm getting a little impatient there. But these notches are not as narrow as I've gone before, so this doesn't need to be too narrow or too thin. Okay. I tend to get too close to the camera. Okay. So I'm just crunching these in, and they're stalling, but that's fine. For hafting, it's good that the base of the notch is dull. And I'm getting lucky that it's continuing to give me flakes. That's what's nice about steel. It's hard enough to really get in there and take advantage of those little areas that you can push on without deforming, because copper will deform and it'll round off and it'll try to catch the edge, and if you push real hard it'll remove some of the copper off the tip, and it won't really be as effective as steel when catching those very slight platforms and pushing off flakes. I don't know if that made any sense. So this is not going to be a serrated edge, although a lot of these side notches were serrated. That would take an extra 15 minutes or so to do those really nice, so I'm not going to do those. Maybe on the next one. I don't want to go over an hour on these, just because it takes so long to upload. And on the real ones, the Indians, no, they like to, I don't know, shape the edge near the notches so that the notches look deeper than they are, I guess. There's usually a raised portion right on the edge of the notch there on a lot of these. I don't know if that's aesthetic or if it helps penetration and cutting, I don't know. But I always do it on mine, on these Western side notches. The Cahokias not so much, but on these out here out west, they did do that shaping around the notch. Sometimes it's really pronounced. Okay, the tip is the last part. And it's the most difficult, so sometimes I'll take a break before I do the tip, but this is my first arrowhead of the day, so I'm not that tired. I better shut up before I break this. I'm just working on the symmetry. And removing lumpy spots on the edge. Make sure the hafting area is wedge shaped. Minutes. Okay, good enough. So that's a, in some places that's called a desert side notch. And in Texas, these are called Ouachita. If there's a notch in the base, it's called a harrow in West Texas. I'm not sure what it's called out west, further out west, like in Arizona, there's a basal notch, and I forget what those are called. Tri-notch, desert tri-notch, I don't know. But anyway, I think you can see the flake scar pattern a little bit. I tried to remove all the steps. There's still some on there. But those can be minimized by a braiding. I'm not going to on this one. A lot of the originals were thinner than this, but they were also smaller in proportion. Let's see. 30 seconds to measure this. It's a little over 5/8 by 1 7/8. Okay, that's it.